can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, God. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves. My heart becomes free. And shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Long for to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Nothing worth more. There's nothing worth more. Come close, can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen the sweetest. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Jesus, your presence, Lord. There is peace, your presence, Lord. There is hope, there is love, your
Good morning, everyone. And Chuck, if you can, you could ask some of the people who are in the lobby. There are some seats in here, and we'll wait just a minute if more people want to come in and fill up some of these seats right here. I know there's a lot of people out in the lobby that are waiting still. So we'll just give a minute for that to happen. Welcome, everyone, to a day we all prayed we would never see. To Daryl and Logan and Lucas and Eli, Tim and Marlene, Michael and Jen, Angela and Cody, family, we have no words for you today other than the words we will share from above. Those of us who knew Annie closely, worked here, counted it a privilege every day she was with us. We may get some accolade someday for what we did for her, but she far outweighed the impact she had on us. So thank you. You lent her to us for a little while, and we appreciate that. Annie has moved home, and we are left to grieve, to cry, and to carry on. Annie was so much to so many people. To me, Annie was a friend, a fellow follower and lover of Christ, and a fellow country music lover. So I begin this celebration of Annie's life and faith by turning to the words of Dierks Bentley. After losing his father, Dierks put a song on his Riser album entitled Here on Earth. The chorus goes like this. There's not a stone in my heart that I've left unturned. Not a piece of my soul that I haven't searched. The only answer for all this hurt is there ain't no answer here on earth. Dierks is right. There is no answer for this day on earth. That is why for the rest of this celebration of Annie's life, we will not look to the words of earth, but we will look to the words of heaven and the words of Scripture. The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians 4:13, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who sleep, that you may not grieve as the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For the remainder of this service, we will look to heaven, where our faith tells us there is no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Rob and Christina have been willing to serve the Lord through music today, and they are now going to lead us in the song. I think they might have already sung it, right? You want to sing it again? Yeah, let's do it again. And it's intentional at its beginning because Annie's life was so much about music, but the beginning today is to invite the Holy Spirit to be present, is to invite God in the third person to work among us today during these few moments.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen sweet of loves, my heart becomes free, and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill me. Thank you. shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, sing Holy Spirit.
By the presence of God, by the presence of His Spirit. Can you feel Him? He's in this room. His presence is here. I believe He's nudging all of us for something. And as much as we may grieve today, all the more we celebrate the life of this beautiful woman, Anne Marie. My name is Brandon Hempel, and Daryl and the boys, and Tim and Marlene, Angela and Michael, thank you for inviting me to be a part of today. It means a lot. It's a great honor to stand here and share and keep these handy. Today I'm a pastor at a church up in St. John's, and my family and I live in DeWitt, Michigan, and I teach at Spring Arbor University. But back in 1999, I was Annie's youth pastor. Just wait for that one to pass. It's funny enough that Brad's section of today is titled Thoughts and Crying, and I'm starting it off. There were three special connections that I had with Annie, her youth pastor. She was a great, great friend to my children, and music. There are many of us here that shared music with Annie. And I have so many wonderful thoughts and memories of her And I was asked to come and share some of those and also read some scripture today that seemed to be near and dear and close to Annie's heart. I still remember the day, and maybe some of these grown-up kids who are in that youth group that are here today too remember when I started teaching a Sunday school class at Green Oak Free Methodist Church. And I walked in there with a shirt and tie and a briefcase. I set it down. It was my very first youth Sunday school class ever. And I believe it was Annie who was the first, maybe one of the students, to come up to me at some point in those weeks and say, "You need to lose the briefcase." I didn't know what I was doing. I was brand new at pastoring, at ministry, at teaching and working with kids. But I believe Annie and her brother and sister and many others were in sixth grade when we first met. And we had a great relationship there at Green Oak. And Annie was one of my best student leaders. She was always asking questions. She was at every leadership retreat I took kids on. She served as a student leader in our youth ministry and did wonderful things. And it was at Green Oak that we actually started sharing music together. Not very much at all. If you don't know me that well, I'm a drummer. And we started to play a little bit there, but eventually the Lord called me here to Williamston, and I came here to serve as a youth pastor for 5 years and lived in Williamston for 9 years. But at some point in that, Annie drifted over to Williamston too. Connections with Brad Lockwood and myself and other people and other friends she had through Teens for Christ, and for so many reasons and for whatever reason, God brought her here, and she landed here. And during a great tragic time in my life, which many of you know about, Annie was the one who really helped to pick up pieces with my kids. She spent time with them, loved them, especially my girls, spent just girl time with them. She would, I had to go back to work at General Motors when I took some time off from ministry, and she would twice a week pick them up from daycare for me, and she'd feed them and play with them and hang out with them, and that went on for quite a few years. And she was just a real, real blessing to my children, but also to me. And some of my fondest memories come from this platform right here, playing music together. And it's so ironic that when I think of Annie and music, the song we just sang is the one I always think of her singing. And when I heard you guys start playing that song, I thought, how am I going to get through this? They're playing that song. Because when I, like many of us can do, close your eyes and hear her voice singing worship to the Lord, that's the song that pops into my mind. And she is and always will be a very precious, precious, precious person to me and my family. But today, we grieve some, but even more than that, we celebrate the beautiful life that Annie led. And all of us here know about her testimony, her faith, about her trust in the Father, about her trust in the Holy Spirit and the Son, and how she lived that in her life, and she sang that through her music. And she shared that with her friends, and she shared that with the people around her. And in this last year or so, amplified so many ways through her Facebook social media presence and all the thousands of people that became a part of that Annie's Army. And her testimony just lived and breathed through that. And it's just absolutely beautiful, beautiful. There are some scriptures that I wanted to share this morning along with just a little bit of my thoughts and experiences with Annie. Pastor Doug and I looked at a lot of her social media and just tried to find some of the verses that she spent a lot of time with. And last night, as I sat at my desk, and this morning, I couldn't narrow it down to just sharing one or two. So there's a few verses here that I want to share with you that were important to her, that she often shared with all of you, and that she often shared with the people around her. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace and redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Matthew 11, verse 28. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Psalm 56, verse 3. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you, in God whose word I praise. In God I trust and am not afraid. What can man do to me? John 14, verse 1 through 4. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare that place for you, I will come back and take you with me, that you may also be where I am. Deuteronomy 36, verse 1. Be strong and courageous. And I can't think of a more strong and courageous person at the moment than Annie. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them, for the Lord your God is with you, and he will never leave you or forsake you. And finally, the verse that we all saw many, many, many times, I've heard Annie share so many times, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the Lord, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, but plans to give you a hope and a future. Those verses were given to us by Annie so many times, and I know that so much here will be shared about her heart's desire that we celebrate today, and that we glorify Christ, and we give praise to the Lord for her life and all that she's done, and that many of us would just take some time to self-reflect because of Annie's life and her testimony. And so I would just hope that all of you would join me in that at some point here as we remember Annie and grieve at her loss, but also celebrate that beautiful, awesome life and that wonderful person. Thanks for letting me share.
I'm Eldon Lee. I was Annie's pastor as a child and through most of her teen years. And she was my adopted daughter. Once or twice in a lifetime, someone comes into your life and changes you. Annie was that person for me. Over the years, she has inspired me, she has challenged me, and she has encouraged me. I first met Annie when she was 8 years old, and I came to Brighton as her pastor. She and I began to make a little game about me being able to tell her and Angela apart. I learned a secret, though, early on so that I could tell them apart. No offense, Michael, though, I didn't have any trouble getting the two of them. But as she developed into a teenager, she and I seemed to develop a very special connection. She made it her mission to try and make me laugh or at least smile every time I stepped into the pulpit on Sunday morning, because invariably I would stand there and hear right smack in the middle of the pulpit was a note from Annie. And of course, at first, I didn't know whether it was some important announcement I was supposed to make or what it was. And so I would open it up and almost crack up, because it was always something very funny. But it became a game with her and I. Annie was, as I said, a very special young lady. And even in those days, she was exploring the possibility of some sort of ministry for her life calling. Now, of course, one expression of that thought was through her music. Even as a teen, she enjoyed using her music as an expression of her love for God. And her musical talents have blessed me, and I know so many of you, many times over the years. At one point in her late teen years, I hurt Annie very deeply. It brings me pain even now. My intentions were good, but my methods in expressing my concerns were terrible. And it made a rift between Annie and I for a while. That was a sad time for me. And for me, it was much like the pain, I think, that comes when there are disagreements that put a wedge between a parent and their child. But after she'd worked through the hurt, just like Annie, she forgave. And we picked up where we left off in our friendship. I recently ran across a very lengthy exchange of emails where she and I just got caught up after that time. And again, she expressed her desire to be in some sort of ministry. Like all of you, it broke my heart when I first learned that her cancer had returned. And I have to say that the Lord and I had many very intense discussions as I reminded him of all of his promises to answer prayer. It was a real challenge to my faith until I finally surrendered Annie to God's all-knowing will. I shared with Marlene just a short few minutes ago that it was just a week before Annie died. And I was praying. I had been believing sincerely that God was going to heal Annie. I mean, I knew it. I couldn't wait for the moment. And I prayed that same prayer. And it was as though God spoke to me as audibly as I speak to you today. And he said, "Eldon, if I grant your request, will you be responsible for Annie the rest of her life?" And I had to say, "God, I'm not you. I can't do that. So, Lord, I surrender her to you." And I think it was at that moment I knew, though I still prayed for her healing, at that moment I knew that he was going to take her home. Popular Christian song became my prayer that restored my faith and trust in God. Lauren Daigle sings these words, "When you don't move the mountains, I need for you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, when I cry out to you, I will trust. I will trust. I will trust in you, Lord." And I determined to place myself and Annie firmly in God's hands. It wasn't only just a few weeks ago that Annie shared with me yet again her renewed tug towards some further kind of ministry in her life. I tried using that as a bargaining chip, actually, with God. That if he wanted her in some sort of ministry, that he had to heal her. However, I came to realize that though Annie had never realized her dream of ministry in the way she had envisioned it, she likely had a much greater ministry as she shared her faith through her illness in these past months and impacted more lives than perhaps she ever would or ever could have otherwise. Even with people she has never met, her dream came true. And also her music and gift in leading worship was more of a ministry than she could ever imagine. I loved always to hear Annie sing. In fact, I was privileged. When Annie was 16 and I moved from Brighton and began leading the church in Port Huron, Annie wrote a song for me, a song that I'll cherish always. And as I listened to her sing it again this week, I thought about how fitting the words of the chorus are today, even as they were then. Listen to the words. Goodbye. Yes, I know it's hard to say. Goodbye doesn't mean forever, always. Goodbye, please know you're in my thoughts and prayers. Goodbye, I hope to see you very soon. As she recorded it originally, the last time, the last chorus, she changed the words from "I hope to see you soon" to "I know I'll see you very, very soon." You know, there's a way that each one of us can know that we'll see Annie again someday. She would tell us all that we can have a personal, saving relationship with Jesus Christ, an intimate friendship, such as all of us have come to know that Annie had. He was the one that sustained her through her battle with cancer. And he's the one who has prepared a home for her in heaven with him, free from all of the pain and the hurt. I know that I or one of these other pastors up here, or many others who are sharing this morning, or who know Annie well, would be happy to share with you how you can have that kind of relationship with God that Annie had. But as for me, I can say, Annie, I know I'll see you very, very soon.
My name's Sarah, and I was blessed to grow up with Annie, Angela, and Mike. My twin brother and I were six months and 1 day older, but we didn't remind you guys too much. But I can't think of my childhood without thinking of the Hardesties, and I wasn't just another kid at their house all the time, probably bugging them, but they just made me be part of the family. I even got my middle name called out sometimes, so we all know what that means. We had countless fun memories, and it was hard to choose some, but I remember getting kicked outside on nice days, and we spent a long time trying to build a fort in the backwoods. I'd say a couple years, but we never quite finished one. But Annie would say it was fun to hammer the nails and pretend like we knew what we were doing. And inside, Marlene would teach us how to make popcorn balls and scotcheroos, and we would spend a long time trying to pick out a video we'd all want to watch, only to have Annie and Angela fall asleep about 5 minutes in, so they maybe made it through the credits back then. And there was a storage attic area in there upstairs. We called it the cubby hole. I'm not sure what it was meant to be, but looking at it now, I don't know how we all fit in there, but we'd all cram in there, and I remember writing names of crushes we had on the wall and crossing them out a little while later, adding our new ones. And I remember in middle school, Annie and I would wear these brightly colored toe socks and pull them up to our knees, roll our pants up and wear our Adidas sandals. It was never a trend, but we thought we were really cool. And in high school, we would carpool to school in our old cars that we were really embarrassed to drive at the time. And during school, we'd meet at each other's lockers and exchange notes. You know, this is before cell phones and texting. And we were in TSCs and Sunshine together, though Annie and Angela were the singers out of us. And I know, as everyone who knows Annie, how musically talented she is, and I feel like she learned how to play guitar in about a week. I don't know how long it really took her, but we drive home late on Sundays after Sunshine concerts, and Annie and Angela would blare their country music and sing along, and then they'd fall asleep, and I'd get to change the station. As we grew older and lived in different cities and eventually different states, we always stayed in touch. And whenever we got together on breaks and holidays, it was as if we didn't miss anything. And Annie would say we were meant to be. And I remember Annie went through a time of wondering if God had plans for her to be single. She just wasn't finding the right guy. It was about a month later, she called to tell me about Daryl. Well, God definitely had plans for her. We're in each other's weddings and celebrating marrying our perfect men, and we all seem to have boys, so that's fun. And her life was too short, but what Annie accomplished in 31 years here on earth is amazing and inspirational. She was an inspiration to many, and a beautiful person inside and out. And I know she'll forever be in my heart as a constant reminder to live life to the fullest and to never take anything for granted. And I wanted to end with a poem today. I thought of you today, but that is nothing new. I thought about you yesterday and days before that too. I think of you in silence. I often speak your name. All I have are memories and pictures and frames. Your memory is a keepsake from which I'll never part. God has you in his arms. I have you in my heart.
My sister was my best friend. She was my other half, and she will always be a part of me. We always talked about when we were getting old what we wanted to do, and the husbands could just tag along. I may have a few more memories with Annie, because we would always get to go on spring break vacations with Jeff and Tracy, and Michael was always grounded. But I thought we should say Annie's favorite joke. A pirate walks into a bar. I'm just kidding. I won't say it. For all of you that have been blessed to hear that, you're welcome. We look alike. We sound alike, except for when we sing. Annie had the country twang, and she said, I sound British. And we could always know what each other was thinking just by a look. I don't know if it was a sister thing or the twin thing, but she even said she felt one of my kidney stones one time. It's Michael's turn for a kidney stone. We were very different, but in the end it made us more compatible. I struggle to think about my life without her. But I know Michael and I will always have that connection. We will forever be triplets. I have the comfort of knowing I will see her again. Annie wanted to do one last post, but her and I never quite got it finished. So I thought I would leave you with Annie's final words. Everyone always says it's the cliche, live like you are dying. But for the last 10 months, that's what I've been doing. I've tried to enjoy each moment with family, friends, church. Even in the midst of uncertainty, pain, and sorrow, I will try to be a better person each day. If I can leave one legacy, it's to have everyone to learn to serve and give first. I know this is not the norm, but it could change your home, your church, and our community if we did this. I also cannot thank you enough for all of you who have helped serve me and my family over this past year. Those who've helped bring a lot of love into our lives. You have a servant's heart, and I thank you. I want you to know how much it means to me that I have heard how many of you have turned towards God and started asking questions about having a faith and what it means. I do not doubt where I will go. My faith does not mean I've led a perfect life, but just that I've asked Jesus into my life and that I've tried day after day to become a better person, and I have trusted and I have faith in him. Thank you. I still need prayer for my boys. If it's one thing I want for them, it's to grow up and be men of God and helping others. XOXO Annie, Jeremiah 29:11.
Sing a couple songs of worship to God, and just to share something. We were very humbled and honored to be asked by Annie months ago to sing at her funeral, which is a very humbling thing to be asked by someone so special. You could just sense it. You can see it in everyone in this room, the impact. But I believe this. I believe her love for singing and her love for worship wasn't in and of itself, but it was who she was singing to. And I think with worship, it's such a scary word to maybe some of us, but to surrender to God, to bow down and worship to him, because the truth is, it's just a matter of time. We're all going to be face to face with God. And I think what an opportunity that Annie's life would point, even in this life. Let's not wait till then. Let's start now. Let's start worshiping now for what we're going to do for eternity. So again, we're just so humbled, and we just want to encourage everyone as we sing these next couple of songs just to remember Jesus. Remember who he is. Remember that he has won the victory. Remember that this life is not it. There's a reason our hearts are torn right now. There's a reason our emotions can be everywhere. But guess what? There is hope in Jesus Christ. And Annie had that hope. And she is alive with Jesus right now, more alive than we are. So as we sing, let's remember that with joy. And as we might feel pain, just remember that hope. Like Pastor was saying earlier, that hope is just our rock. Jesus is our rock. This song is called Revelation Song, and we're just going to sing, Holy, Holy, Holy is the Lord God Almighty. I believe God's going to do something incredible in our hearts and our minds, and I believe that's what Annie would want.
And I will adore you.
I jumped up out of order, but I wanted Brad to come up here. So Annie's gift to the Church of Music was incredible. It was always passionate. It was always from her heart. But she would say a lot in the last few months of her life, "This is my story," through a song. Well, I don't know if you discovered it or she did, Lauren's song, right? Was it you or her? Okay, it was Brad, and I think he brought it to Annie. But this song that Pastor Lee quoted the words from, "Trust in You" by Lauren Daigle, right?
Yes.
And so they're going to do it now, but I want you to know, I'm sorry, I wasn't rude, I wasn't looking on my phone for a new message, but I have a long list of texts from Annie in there about what to do today. So I was checking my text to see if potentially she had updated today to tell me in the moment. But anyway, I think it was Facebook now through Annie's Army, but Annie put it out there for all of you to say, and her words about this song were, "I believe every word."
Amen.
Every word. And as Rob and Christina do this song, I want you to get the words. I want you to see what Annie believed in through this song. This is an incredible song to say you believe every word in. I mean, this is an incredible, but you know her, and you know she did. So I needed to say that. Thanks for being my crutch. I didn't let you say anything.
Happy to be here.
Okay, all right. So anyway, but I wanted you to know that ahead of this song. Rob, Christina.
Every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, face you by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. Not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, since I cry out to you, I will trust, trust in you. I cry out to you.
Hopefully I turned it on correctly. Thanks, you guys. 7 months ago, I sat in Annie's house, across from her, and she was on the couch. And she said, "I'm not going to let you sing at my funeral." "I can do it," I said. "No, you can't," she said. I don't know what kind of reputation I have, but even as Eldon referred earlier on this sermon, on the schedule for today, welcome Pastor Doug, thoughts in scripture, Pastor Brandon, thoughts in prayer, Pastor Eldon, thoughts in crying, Pastor Brad. It's just not fair. Maybe these other men just aren't in touch with their emotions correctly. Thank you. I do have something to say about that. Yeah, I'm just a baby, I know it. Annie would watch me carefully at the piano, and when I would get teared up in a song, she would take over the melody. All those who go here, you want me to use this? Okay. I'm taking it off, it's bugging me. All right. And I'm shutting it off so we don't double up. Okay. Annie would take over the melody for me. And that didn't happen every Sunday, but I bet it happened every couple of weeks. And it was a bit of a joke in between the band members. What Annie did look at me and say, which is interesting, "You can't do the music because you won't be able to, you'll cry. But I want you to talk about who I really was and tell my personal story." And I said, "Oh, sure, and I won't cry during that either." And let's put it together. I mean, Sarah, Angela, great job by you two. And you cried, so I can cry if I want to, all right? It's not that it's my party or anything, but I can cry if I want to. It all comes back to music. Now, I want to tell all of you to put down your handkerchiefs, put down your Kleenexes, and quit crying, because that's the first message Annie wanted me to deliver to you, okay? No time for you to talk, Steve, but would you stand up for a minute, Steve Vanderlaan? This beautiful and wonderful man, thank you, Steve. When Annie was 18 years of age, after playing guitar with me in Teens for Christ for 3 years, after Annie and Angela had been with us, and I'll go back to that story in a minute, she said, "I want to come play music at your church." I said, "I want you to come play music in my church. That'd be great. How do your parents feel about it?" And she said, "It doesn't matter." How many would raise your hand and say that to Annie? We all love and know, right? Doesn't matter. I'm going to do what I want to do. Right, Daryl? How many years were you married? Okay, 6. I just wanted to make sure you remembered. Okay. Remember, I'm supposed to be filling in her role here for a minute, so. So she came up here, and it was only about 5 or 6 weeks after she was here with Stephen Barb's son, who was a teenager, passed away in a car wreck. And so we were at camp meeting, and I had to come back to do the music at a funeral for a 17-year-old boy. For some people I loved and cared about, Steve taught in our community for years, Stephen Barb, everyone knew him, huge funeral in the old sanctuary. Right at the front, there's just me on the piano and Annie sitting beside me, saying, "I don't remember ever being at a funeral before." It's packed. People are sobbing, of course. She connected with Steve. If you see him afterwards, just talk to him about it, because we don't have time today. But they have been fast friends from the day of Steve's son's funeral, like you wouldn't believe. They sat up, and Annie just kept looking at Steve, and Steve just kept looking at her, and the worship here with Annie singing was one of the things I know they missed the most now that they moved away. Now, 7 weeks after she came here, So the week after the funeral, she came to me after church and said, I think I have to go back to my home church. Did she ever tell you this story? I said, what do you mean? It's really going well. You people cry way too much. I can't stand all the emotion. I said, oh, come on, it's not that bad. All right, watch next Sunday. Next Sunday, we're crying about something. She's taking over the melody for me. I'm like, you're right. So I said, you've got to learn to cry, is what I told her. So then she got married. Ha ha ha, that'll be funny later. Sorry, Daryl. That'll be my only one, I hope. You know, I don't know, but I hope. All right. For the last 10 months of her life, I have sat at this piano and I have looked at you a little bit, looked at my music a little bit, and stared at Annie. She's been standing right there with her guitar. And I have done my best to memorize and hold on to the Annie that we all know and love. So why am I the person she asked to do this? I span all those years from the time she was a 14-year-old till now. I was with her as she became a member of the music and discipleship group Teens for Christ. Actually, the one that I fell crazy about first was Angela, because she wanted to get in the leadership group and Annie didn't. And so I got to know Angela better, and Angela is a marvelous singer. And then I got to know Annie better, and she is a marvelous singer and could play guitar too. So I threw Angela aside and said, I need the guitar player. No, just kidding. No. And after Annie came here, I said, Angela, you come here too? And she said, no. Okay, so. But I did. All right, just shaking your head on that one. All right. When she moved here at 18, she had some roommates. I was here through all the insecurities of her dating life. I was here in church after one dating relationship didn't pan out, and I was counseling her after church, and she was telling me how unattractive she was. And I was telling her that she was one of the most beautiful girls in the church and not to worry about it. And so in typical Annie fashion, she said, right now I can name 10 women more beautiful than me in this church. So I said, you name them. And so she started right down the list. So I said, that's not true. That's not, well, now you're really trapped as a man, right? Because if you say, no, you're prettier than her. Okay, so I gave up. I gave up that fight. She got her own condominium. She was kind of lonely here at times with her job. And she had such a wonderful family. And Tim, Marlene, Cody, Angela, Jen, Michael, it is not my right to be here. It is not my privilege. And Daryl, though we have been accountability partners all these years and we are best of buddies, no one can stand in her shoes or say what she has to say. And it is just an honor. It is an honor to do this. And I she knew I would make everyone laugh is why she made me do this. So I did their premarital counseling, and for money, I will tell you some secrets later. I know that when issues emerge, Daryl is the kind to try to let them play out before we have to force it. And Annie was the kind to get a bulldozer and run over it. And I know that was a strain at times, because when you marry someone who already has a child from a previous marriage, you're going to have some issues that just natural, just even delivering the child for visitation. And there were times that if you knew Annie, as I do, that she was angry or that she was pushy or that she was sad. So guess she was human, huh? So we're not here today to say she was perfect. But we are here to say that, boy, she came close. And I want to tell you why I think so. I don't trust other people with music. When I go to other events and other people sing, this is awful, but it's hard for me to sing sometimes. If they don't do it in the right order, they do it a little too fast, a little too slow, if they don't do the phrasing just right. You know, if you're with me and you've been coming to this church for years, I might say the words here, break here, and if someone else goes straight through. And so it's hard. It's hard doing music. And Annie and I had an amazing relationship musically. I trusted her from the time she was like 18 to take the tempo, to run the beat, to make the song be what the song could be. So many of our songs, even if I was singing it, she would start it. I can't get, unless you're a musician, maybe I can't get you down to the bottom of that, but even the band, the drummers know, they're supposed to hold the beat, but I'm supposed to run the beat, because I'm on a piano, so they're supposed to listen to me. My son's shaking his head over there, because he plays drums for me. They're supposed to, like, I run the beat. I run the show. I'm the almost 60-year-old guy, and I'm in charge of this. I've been doing this for years, right? Except when it came to Annie. And if we practice a song too fast, too slow, didn't have the right feel for it, Annie would say, well, you don't have it right. You just tell me. Now, that wasn't now. That was since she's been 18. She's been telling me that, right? You know that, right? Daryl, you definitely know that. So, her voice was magic. I could sing 20 songs, the best I could ever sing. Annie would sing one, and people would come to me afterwards and say, who's that girl that's singing with you? I took her to camp meeting, and she sang in front of a few hundred or maybe 500-600 people, and I had at least 4 people come to me and say, the music was so good, who is that lady with you? Well, don't you want to tell me how good I am? No? Who is that lady that was with you? She's so good. She became a leader. She became so confident, even from high school when she and Angela wanted to form their own little group and go around singing, and they've been so good. Even when we would do a movement in song like, I will trust in you, we would do it together without even thinking about it. And I will give you credit, Angela, because you and I did that together too in high school when we'd make the move. Annie and I would do it with the piano and the guitar. There was a relationship there I cannot describe to you unless you do it, but we were tight, musically and personally. It's different because she's like a daughter to me and a partner and so many other things. I will tell you this. She let me know which song she didn't like. And I didn't really, let me rephrase it. I wasn't really supposed to pick them again. Dave Kruger's favorite song is Days of Elijah. Annie was sick of it. Every once in a while, I like to do Trading My Sorrows because it's old and everyone knows it. Annie was tired of it because they were doing that back when she was a high schooler. All right? At the Vanderlaan funeral, we did I Can Only Imagine, and she forbade me to ever do it in church ever again because it would make her cry. So we have never, since that funeral, done that song in church. You don't know that until right now because Annie wouldn't let me. And it's okay. As Daryl knows, whatever Annie wants, keep us all happy, right? I did that at a lot of funerals, and she even did it at funerals. Okay. So who is Annie really at this age of 31? Jeez, you've already heard 2 pastors, and you got 1 to go. So I'm sorry, you know, just move around a little bit and keep them going. But I went to this group of power moms. Would all you power moms stand up for just a minute? Yes, stand up for just a minute. Come on, Lori. Stand up. Just cover your eyes. I don't want people to see you and crying. Where's the rest of the group? This is a little group that's been doing a lot of stuff. Heather has a thank you, ladies. Thank you. And their husbands, like, they did this wonderful fundraiser that Adam helped with, and Jeff drew many hands, and all the Annie's arm and stuff. I went to those ladies because they've been hanging around here a lot in the last couple of years. And I asked for some descriptive words. And I'm not going to tell the story after every word, but before I do that, I just want you to tell me, how many of you today in this room, by a raise of your right hand, would tell me, I feel like I had a special connection to Anne Scholten? Raise your hand. How many of you feel you had a special connection to her? Okay. Half the people in this room, at some point, have felt a special connection to her
most funerals, there's 20% that had a special connection, others that knew them. But for some reason, whether it's because of social media, so many of us have a special connection to her, okay? You got that? So here's what her buddies have said. She's strong. Can we deny that at all? No. When I was with her a week and a half ago, my wife and Doug and Kathy and I, and a couple weeks ago now, and she's in that bed trying to pump the pain up and then turning and smiling to us, even though the pain is so bad. You guys walked through it right to the end. Boy, she handled the pain. She didn't like it. Boy, she's strong. Another word I got from the ladies was tenacious, hanging in there. Boy, she was. But she was tenacious about a lot of things. Like if Daryl didn't do what she wanted, she would tenacious until it happened at some point. Right? Unless someone could change her mind. She was compassionate. Boy, the biggest reason she did all the social media is because she wants you people to know that Jesus is real. That is the biggest reason. She didn't want everyone to know her. She wasn't trying to be a show off. She wanted you to know that Jesus is real. One of the ladies said best friend, and there are about 30 people in here who probably say best friends. Someone said forever, and I think it's true because the legacy she's given us will last and last. We can't deny it. Annie grew from a young lady who was like my mentee, you know, I was her mentor and she was learning to lead, till the point came where she would ask me to help her with stuff. When Nick and Kendra Church got married, they asked her to do the music and she said, Brad, I'm going to ask them if you can help me play the piano
with that because I want the sound to be a little better. So I said, sure, if that's okay. So it switched, right? And I have been arguing with God a lot, Eldon, about this because I had it all figured out. I would slowly ride off into the sunset and Annie would take care of everything here and lead worship. And once in a while, I would come back and play piano for her. So I'm trying not to be mad about it. And that comes and goes. Someone said that she was brave. I can't imagine loving everyone else the way she has been these last 10 months. Going through what she's gone through. And I've never seen anything more cool than her desire to make memories with her boys before she was gone. Another lady said everlasting. Goes with that word forever. The only two that are really similar in this. But the impact is going to go forever. And the change that can happen in your life would be everlasting if you'll let it. Another lady said awe-inspiring. That's perfect. I am in awe of what she has said and done and how she has carried herself during this time. I am in awe of Tim and Marlene for the way they have rallied around this family. I am in awe of Daryl for hanging in all of this stuff that he and the whole Scholten family has gone through. They said selfless, and I think it's true. Annie didn't really want the attention, but she wanted to be up front. Does that make sense? She wanted to sing, and she wanted to tell people about Jesus, and she wanted to be in ministry, but she didn't want it to be about her. And when she was genuine, I don't think she could not be genuine, because there was no disingenuous moan in her body. It was you. What you saw is what you got. And one lady said spicy when she wanted to be. And that's true, because every one of us who knew her well has felt that side of her when she's let us know what's right and what's wrong in her eyes. So I have some words for me. Thank you, ladies, by the way, for standing for those words. My first word is fierce, which is one of my new favorite choruses, by the way. We'll be doing it here soon. She was fierce. We were at a leadership team meeting, and Doug and I have been friends since we were 18, so that's 22 years ago now. That's 42 years ago now, actually, 41. But sometimes we don't communicate that well, and things would be happening with the worship team, and Doug would want something, and I'd want something else, and Annie would feel caught in the middle. And we were at a leadership team meeting, and there are some of the leadership team members who are going to shake their heads at this. And Doug was talking about something, and Annie had had enough of whatever it was, and she just let go. And I'm just starting to cry, and Annie's just crying while she's letting us all have it, letting Doug have it more than anyone else. But, I mean, she's just going at it. And she's just going at it, and I think this Doug and I both lost a third of the hair loss. right at that moment when Annie let it go right there. I mean, it was like, whoo. She has it in her. Not bad. Good. She was loyal. She would continue to be your friend. Eldon, you talked earlier about when you and she had that rift. Well, I got to hear every bit of that rift. I want you to know that. And she was at fault too, and you know that. You didn't admit that. She was hard-hearted and hard-headed, as you well know. As you well know. And Daryl, as you well know. She was hard-headed and hard-hearted at that time, and you were just trying to reach out to her, but you reached out too hard when she was too stubborn to listen. And I would say, Eldon just loves you. I don't care. But you've always loved him. I do love him. I just don't want to talk to him. Okay, it came around. She was faithful to the end. Okay. Yes, I could talk for half an hour more. Here's what I want to end with. We're going to read her last text messages with me in a minute. So thank you, Drew, for bringing my phone up that I forgot. 4 points from me. These are the points that Annie was living these last few months. And, four pastors, four sermons, what can I say? We have to look at this through the right lens. Annie had learned to look at it. It's not about looking at her death. It's about looking at her life and the effect of her life. You ever go to a 3D movie and you take the glasses off, you can't see it very well, right? Right? Huh? Are you there? Okay. All right. You have to put the right glasses on. If you look at this as our loss, if you look at this as not what you wanted, this doesn't make sense. If you look at it through your belief in Jesus and through faith, this is what Annie was doing. She said to me, right as I'm getting into the ministry even more, he's letting me die. Why would he do that? I said, I don't know. I still don't think you're going to die. That was up to just 3 weeks ago. I said, I think he's going to heal you, Eldon. I was right with you. And she said, nope, I don't think so anymore. I did a few months ago. I don't think so anymore. But I do know that he's doing something because of me. There's the key. She saw it through the lens of faith. Did she question God? Yes. Did she hang tough anyway? Yes. So look at it through faith, not through loss. Number two, look beyond the trouble. You know, I said she was tenacious and loyal and faithful. She would find the truth and live for it. It's about hanging in there with your church, your friends, your family, your relationship. You know, things are going to go wrong when you come to this church or go to any church. And instead of running or instead of fighting, hang in there. And it will work out. And that's what she was doing. And hang in there. The right lens. Look past the trouble to the good that can happen. Ask God about the what, not the why. And this is where she and I got hung up. I don't like the why. I don't know the why. We don't know the why. Doug doesn't know the why. I can't figure out the why. Maybe God will never tell me the why. But I know the what, because you're all here, because there's sometimes 30,000 people who 40,000 people who see the things that were posted by Annie's army. They're hearing about God. I did a wedding this weekend. It's so weird. Annie passes, then we go north, and I did my brother-in-law's wedding way up at a lake up north, a big party. Everyone's having a good time. I'm trying to be happy for everyone else. My brother cries when he does. We all cry when he does his vows, my brother-in-law. My new sister-in-law, we all cry when she does her vows. I pull out my little talk, and then I tell everyone about Annie, and we all cry about Annie. I don't use her name. I don't do any specifics. I just said I just lost someone dear to me this week, blah, blah, blah. So the point was you need to cherish every minute with your new spouse. Cherish every minute. You don't know how many minutes you get. Take everyone and cherish every minute, right? I shake hands afterwards, and a lady who is the sister of the ex-wife says, I know who you were talking about because I've been following her on Facebook. What? How does that happen? I'll tell you how it happens. God is using this. The what, the opportunity, is so much bigger than the why. There's so many people you need to tell about Annie, and you need to point them to what Annie has been standing for. And then last but not least, saddest thing is that Annie's name is going farther and farther down the list here. And he always wanted to make it right for everyone else, and that's what we need to do. Brad, we found out I'm dying. My body is shutting down, and I have a week or maybe a little more to live. I'm not telling the whole public until tomorrow, but I'm telling family and close friends today. I'm sorry to tell you this over text. This sucks, and I don't really know what to say yet. I didn't realize I'd never see my house and my dog or be with my kids again. And then, just like Annie, she said, thanks for not sharing this with anyone else yet. Well, you just told me not to, but anyway. I wrote back, Annie, I have no words. I want to come see you as soon as I can. I promise to be Daryl's faithful friend. I made it till now. Did pretty good. Then I had to say your name. What the heck? I'm not crying about Annie, but I'm crying about you. What the heck? All right. Annie, I have no words. I want to come see you as soon as I can. I promise to be Daryl's faithful friend as long as I am here and able to be. I cannot seem to accept this as reality. And she said, thank you. I love you and cannot thank you enough for all that you've done for me over the years. You've taught me so much and a lot of who I am. It's because of you. Thank you. Why is she worried about me right now? Right? So I say, well, I love you so very much too. You're like a daughter and a partner all in one. But hopefully you know all that already. And she just wrote, I do, with a freaking smiley face. What? She's laying in the bed that they tell her she'll probably die in, though she did get to move to a different hospice. And she's giving me a smiley face. Oh, man. I love you, Annie. I appreciate all you've done for me. Tim and Marlene, love you. Michael, Angela, I love you guys. Daryl, I really love you, man. Annie would have died for any one of us, so we need to live for her. Let's do it.
Thanks. You wouldn't do it another way. So many amazing things are happening. I just have to say to you, in the midst of all the pain, like in the basement now, there is another church that came to our church and said, we want to serve you guys by doing all the meal stuff so you guys can all share in Annie's deal. That's the whole deal of this moment that Annie did. She just brought all these people together around this cause. And like the rest of the people on the platform, we had a relationship with her. Mine was that on the 19th of October, she texts me and said, Doug, this is what you will do. My phone's right there. You want to look at it? It's right there. You will preach a come to Jesus message. First, an aside. I met a girl, Sweet Annie. It's different for girls, Sweet Annie. I like the sound of that. Sweet Annie, you should be here, though. You live like you were dying, so humble, so kind. Sweet Annie, you were a riser because you were changed by something in the water. Sweet Annie, you knew John Cougar, John Deere, John 3:16. To you, hunting, fishing, and loving every day was just wasted time. Sweet Annie. In your house, there was lots of noise, but you loved it and said, play it again. People who saw you said, she's doing what she likes, and I want what she's got. Sweet Annie. Because of you, Daryl can die a happy man. The way you lived, I could almost hear you saying, I'm going to make you miss me. Sweet Annie. So today we are the true believers in a place you called my church. We are gathered here dealing with the four toughest words we know. Thy will be done. That's just an Annie and me thing. That's my country music connection with Annie. Most every one of those is the title of a song. And on my phone and iPad by Zach Brown is a song that goes, Sweet Annie. I want to stay with you a while. This road's been putting miles on my heart, sweetheart. And it's a song about Sweet Annie. I remember telling Daryl, hey, probably sing that to Annie all the time. Not so much, he said. So I left that because I'm not sure anybody called her sweet. By the way, I think she was a great lady, but sweet probably would have been a word she didn't really want to associate with. Just so much. But you know what? She loved music, and we talked about music today. And how Annie shared some music in that song that she sang. You know, she couldn't sing it. Then she came back to sing it about her trust factor and everything. I really thought, you know, what you'll do is you'll just get up there. And Annie probably sung the message. And then it came back to me. You have to preach the come to Jesus message. And so then I was searching on Facebook. And I thought, well, what if Annie preached the message already? And if you go on the church's website and you'll see Brad. This is great, right? So I'm gone on vacation. I go, Brad, you got to preach. He goes, okay, I'll let Annie do it. So Brad gets up for like 30 minutes and brings Annie up. And what's everybody talking about? You should have heard Annie. I had people that were here, never been here before to the church, first Sunday. They go, wow, we were there. That girl is amazing. So if you go on the website and listen to Annie's 15 minutes, she preached a great sermon, by the way. And some of it, she says things like this. She says, I want everyone to be in heaven with me one day. I want to invite people to church who have never been invited to church. I want to invite someone back who hasn't been to church for 6 months. And then she kind of hammers us with, God isn't someone we need one day. He's someone we need every day. She said, Brad asked her, he says, come on, Annie, tell us in the last part of your life, what matters most to you? And this is Annie. Go online. Listen, this is Annie. I want to raise my boys to be godly men. I want them to be in heaven with me someday. I don't want to remember every day could be our last and that we need to live like we're right with God. She said, the path isn't wide, the path is narrow. We like to think God loves us no matter what, that he's for us and he's a great God. But he calls us to do certain things, to love him and to follow him. She said, I spent a long time loving him, but not living like I was going to heaven today. She reminded us that on her mirror is a series of messages that went through a couple of years ago called You'll Get Through This. She said, on my mirror is that saying, you'll get through this. And I look at that every day. But she said, I want to go to heaven. Listen, I want to go to heaven the right way. I want to go to heaven the right way. So I thought, well, I'll just preach Annie's message. because Annie already preached it. Maybe it's a song, maybe it's a message, and then I just read that text again. I'm like, really? The text reads in full. I just really want to tell them all the world is wrong. It's not about what makes you happy. It's a narrow road facing death. You have to face up to those things in your life, and you have to try to understand they're just not worth it. Is heaven really worth the bar on Saturday? The emotional affair at work? Something, she says. Preach something like that. What if I just preach that? So I went for a walk. I went for a don't mess this up walk. Because I could tell it was all coming together. And I've been listening to people talk about this day. And I knew, man, just do not mess this up. But you have to stay true. She asked you, you were her pastor. She asked you, preach a come to Jesus message. So I went for a walk. And it didn't turn out like I thought it was going to, but it did turn out in the way I hoped. And then I had peace in my heart when I finished that I knew what to say, but it was incredibly off in left field. So I went for a walk, and I'm walking, and I'm asking God, come on, what am I going to do? And this, all this is flowing around my head, music, the way she preached, how she lived her life. You're going to miss her. You're going to see that music stand. It's going to crush you next Sunday, and all this stuff's going through my heart. And he brings this one image to my heart and my mind. It's the image of part of the crucifixion of Jesus. Now listen, you got to stay with this. I'm not so sure it was how Annie lived. I'm not so sure it was what Annie sung. I'm not so sure if it was what Annie said. To me, it might just be how Annie died. I've not met very many people who have died well. I don't mean that in any offense to anyone, but she's too young to go. And we all knew that, and she knew that. That story of the crucifixion is the story that Mark records, that there's this Roman centurion, he's standing at the foot of the cross and he's watching, and it says that when Jesus breathed his last, the centurion was standing right up in front of him, saw the way he breathed his last, and he said, now listen, he said, truly, truly, this man was the Son of God. You see, that Roman centurion didn't believe until Jesus died. Not many people are willing to die for what they believe. I'm not going to fill you in. It was not good. Brad mentioned when we went to Ann Arbor, the four of us went to see Annie, and we kind of knew what the trip was about. She knew what the trip was about, and she was there in full flavor. She was there in all of her splendor, if you will, joking with us in crazy ways, displaying how she lived her whole life. She asked about other people. She said, well, how's Jason doing? Her friend Jason, who had been diagnosed with brain tumors. Annie, how's Jason doing? Oh, how's your family? And she asked all those questions. And then she just kind of went off the page. And it was just like, what? And she just said, it's not so bad that I'm dying. It said, I'm going to die fat. Did she not say that? I'm like, what? Person does this? But listen, everyone. She wasn't afraid of dying. I was there the Tuesday before we went, just Daryl and Annie and I, and I was there right after Marlene, Tim, everyone had left. She had met with the oncologist. There wasn't anything to do. Hospice is the only course. And it was an awful 1 hour. And it was raw, and there was emotion, and all of us were crying, and there were things being said about who will take care of my boys, and what will happen with Daryl, and what about the project at the church, and you know what? That wasn't a fear of dying. That was a passion for living out the call that God had placed on her life. I don't know why it happened that way. Alden talked about she was 16 years old probably around then when she felt God nudging her into things. I was on a walk maybe 2 months ago after Annie had stood up here singing one day and said, I've had this dream about being completely healed and serving in the church. And all of a sudden it came to me like, bring her on. So we officially met and we made a motion and we brought Annie on. Annie's the first staff member I've ever had to pass away. I don't know why she didn't get more time. You've heard enough about that. Annie truly believed Jesus was the Son of God. You heard it when she sang. You were inspired by it when she preached. You saw it in the way she lived. And I think she shouted it when she died. Many people will sing and preach and live for God, but I don't know very many will hold to him to the end. The way Annie died for me was to come to Jesus' message. She never stepped back. She never doubted or recanted or said there was another way. She left all kinds of evidence of that, everyone. It's all over Facebook. It's in the words that she said from this platform, not just that one message, but oftentimes before she sang, it was her saying, I believe every word of this Trust in You song. I don't think my part is to say much more. It's to ask you what you'll do with Annie. For some of you, I'll be frank, some of you are called to carry on Annie's legacy of helping other people who struggle with the end-of-life stuff like Annie did, Annie's army. Doggone you, don't stop. To respond to Annie's passion for living, reach out to people who are dying. They need people to love on them and surround them and to bring food to their house and to be support mechanisms for them and to raise funds for them. They need that Annie's Army kind of passion. And as the soldiers who fought in that Annie's Army endeavor, just because the leader's gone, don't give up the cause. That's your come to Jesus moment, is to pick up Annie's legacy that way. There are others of you, frankly, you are that person who has at arm's length God for a long time, and now you've stood figuratively and watched Annie pass away, and what do you think? What will your response be? Do you believe he's truly the Son of God? If you do, you have to take action. You have to take and do your part. Listen to those words. Annie said, the road is not wide, the road is narrow. Narrow meaning the people who will walk that path must be people not just of what they say, but of what they do. That's her legacy. That's her come to Jesus moment. It's everything that she did and everything that she said. So on that crazy don't mess this up walk, I asked God, how? And he said, be like Annie. Don't mess around. You see, the longer Annie lived and the closer she came to death, the less tolerant she was on one hand and the more tolerant on the other. She would now tolerate that things are messy and things don't happen, but she wouldn't tolerate half-truth. And here's the real, honest-to-goodness truth. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Your part is to say yes. I don't know when it was, early on in the cause, I started being a bracelet wearer, not a bracelet guy. I have two of them on today, one for Errol, one for Annie, and one for Jason. Those are how they start, this is how they end, all faded. But if I had anything to tell you about Annie and about what she wanted today was come to Jesus. The last time I saw her, she was hurting bad. It was awful. We were trying to let the medicines take effect so Annie would be okay. And it was quiet. I had to go. It's like time to go, and I couldn't bring myself to go. So I was trying to figure out what to do and flashed back to an hour and a half earlier. The facility that Annie was in was a long down-the-hill driveway thing. And that Tuesday afternoon, I'd driven in the middle of the afternoon there, and just before turning in the driveway, at the house directly across the road from the driveway was a truck hooked up to a U-Haul. And I made the corner to head for the hospice facility, and that spirit inside of me said, tell him she's moving. Tell him she's moving home. And just like you need, I need, my spirit knew the love of God in that moment that said, I made this possible. I conquered death for Annie and for anyone who will believe. As much as you don't understand, it's time for her to move home. Annie's message didn't leave any of us out. I think it was first to me. We had some pretty intense discussions about what church should be and not be and those kind of things. But for me, I think she wanted to know, would I be the first to say, I heard you, Annie. I'm coming to Jesus in a brand new way. And I think some of you need to do that today too. And you might have one of these on, and there might be one of them here. But I'm going to leave mine with Annie on her casket today as a visible sign of me coming to Jesus, because that's what Annie wanted me to do. And she's going to lead us out of here with a song. We have about a 3-minute song of Annie on this platform singing a song. And it's going to be hard, I'll admit to you, it's very emotional. But I'm asking some of you to do something for Annie. Nah, do it for you. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus, get up out of your chair this morning when that song plays. If you got a wristband on, put it on here. If you don't, grab one of these and make a public declaration of coming to Jesus. It's the most costly thing you'll ever do. It's more difficult to understand maybe than anything you've endeavored. But you know it's what God's asking you to do today. So we were quiet in that room, and I decided it's time to go. I didn't want to disturb her, but I had to tell her. I leaned forward to the bed and got by her face and said, Annie, see you later. It'll either be here or it'll be you know where. Well done, Annie. Well done.
Thank you.
Who will come to Jesus today? Is it you? The you that Annie prayed for, that she sang for, or lived for, and ultimately died in front of? Well, she's saying right at the very end, it's going to be hard and you might be scared, but come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Right now, just get out of your chair and come to Jesus. The Bible says, greater love is no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Jesus laid down his life for Annie, and Annie gave everything she had for his cause. Well done, Annie. Well done. That's what Jesus is saying. Well done. To everyone in this room, we owe such a debt of gratitude to her for living well and finishing well. Let's pray. God, words seem darned inadequate today. A lot of them were said, and I thank you for every one of them, but it's just so hard. But you're the God that gives peace that passes understanding, and you're the God that says, not my will to your own Father, but your will be done. And today, God, we need to say we love you in the midst of our pain and our loss and our questions. You're still a holy, good God. You're still a good, good Father. And he knew that.
walk alongside each one in this room now with the Spirit of God, the way to cope with today, that we might keep hope alive and spread the love of God that Annie so lived for in this town and in this world, this crazy place. Daryl and the boys, they need your special presence now, God. Tim and Marlene are hurting parents and kids that don't know what to do, and siblings that are lost. And God, we just, you're our source, you're everything right now. We're just coming to you for everything. For those in the room today, God, that this is just so hard to handle and so much about a faith they don't understand, just bring your presence to them. They just need to know. I needed a U-Haul to show me that it was okay. They need something to make it okay. Just show them your love in one way or another, because you are still a good, good Father. This has been your house and always will be your house. And Annie will be with us in her spirit constantly, but as we go forward from this day, God, just surround us, envelop us with you. All this has been because of you, and we thank you for being present today. In Christ's name, amen. So they're going to come and escort Annie out. And as you leave the sanctuary today, make your way to the right. There's about 300 to 400 balloons, pink balloons that have blown up in the door that says offices. Make your way, get a balloon, make your way to line both sides of the driveway. We'll wait. And as Annie passes by, say, see you later. It's not goodbye, it's see you later. It's see you later. That's what she wants. She said it over and over. I want to see everyone in heaven. It's a see you later. Okay?